So 2 minutes and then the streaming starts. Okay, so we are live. Okay, so thanks for joining us. Today we have the pleasure to have Ronnie Bartsch from Bar-Ilan University. So Ronnie graduated, first had a master in physics at the University of Constance, then went to Bar-Ilan for a PhD in physics. And then he spent several years at Harvard Medical School with Plum and Ivanov, I guess, and then at Boston University. And finally was returned back to Bar-Ilan University as a professor and is in the Department of Physics, but working in interdisciplinary application in physiology. And today he will tell us about critical transitions and self-organization in sleep dynamics. So thanks very much, and please, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Stefano, for the invitation and the nice introduction. So I first want to thank my collaborators, because usually I forget this slide in the end. So special thanks goes to Plamen for introducing me to this field of physics applied to physiology and sleep regulation. And some of the ideas I present today, they come from my postdoc years in Boston and also before. And I worked on these projects together with Shlomo Havlin and Hila Twier. Leo Applebaum did some of the experiments, and also acknowledge time and discussions with Jan Kandelhardt and Thomas Penzel in Germany, and of course grants, our Marie Curie Fellowship and BSF. So when we talk about sleep, we need to discuss first, I want to give a small introduction into sleep medicine and how sleep is analyzed nowadays. And here we need to talk first about the EEG, electroencephalography, that is measuring electrical activity from the brain. And the invention of EEG has a very nice prehistory, actually. And Hans Berger, who is considered the inventor of EEG, he had, during his army time, he had an accident that almost killed him. And it is said that shortly after this accident, he received a telegram from his family that lived 100, 150 kilometers away from the place where the accident happened. They could possibly not know that something happened to him, and asking him about his well-being. And it turned out that his sister, Hans Berger's sister, to whom he was very close, she had the feeling that something terribly has happened to her brother and urged her father to send a telegram. So Hans Berger was puzzled how she could possibly know. And he thought about that his brain at the time of the accident sent out some waves that his sister received then. And the rest of his life he spent on looking for this communication channel, so to say. And he hooked up people with electrodes. And here you see, actually, so in 1924 was the time that he started with it. It only got published in 1929. And here's one of the first recordings of what is called a Berger's wave or alpha wave. This is a typical 8 to 12 hertz rhythm of the order of 50 microvolt. And so on the below, you have a reference signal of 10 hertz. So this alpha wave is pretty basic, and everybody has alpha waves. When you just close your eyes, then alpha waves appear typically on the back of your head. And in general, the EEG is a mixed signal of many frequencies, is on the order of 0.5 to 100 microvolts, so about 100 times lower than in an ECG. And physiological relevant frequencies are in the range of 0.5 to 4 hertz, which is which are delta waves, to high frequency gamma waves in the order of 30 to 100 hertz. So the EEG was invented, but it took almost 30 years until it was used in sleep medicine. And these are the two guys that first came up with the idea to hook up people in the lab, in the sleep lab, with an EEG. So actually, Azarinsky, who was a PhD student of Nathaniel Kleidman. Kleidman is one of the big pioneers of sleep research and circadian rhythm research. He lived for a couple of months in a cave in order to study circadian rhythms. And Azarinsky put these electrodes on people, and ultimately they also discovered REM sleep by doing this. And an interesting side note is that Kleidman lived until quite a respectable age, 104. Here's a picture of him at the sleep conference in 1995, at the age of 100 years. He still was quite fit and active in research. Azarinsky didn't have quite such a fate. He died in an accident, in a car accident, close to his house in San Diego. And there are some people that say that he fell asleep while driving and bumped into a tree. So here we see characteristics of light sleep. So these are sleep spindles here, typically in the order of 12 to 14 hertz of half a second duration, and these K complexes. So this way, people in the lab identify in the EEG if somebody's in light sleep or in a different sleep stage. And in deep sleep, you have this characteristic delta waves. They are really, they look like a Greek delta in the order of 0.5 to 2 seconds, and they are very high. They are 75 microvolt. And in REM sleep, didn't show an example here, but the EEG is very similar to wake, but the EMG, so your muscle tone, is equal to zero. This is because in REM sleep, you typically experience dreams, and having a low muscle tone means you cannot act out your dreams and hurt your partners. I mean, some people, they have a condition that also would not give this muscle atonia, and they then punch their bad partners. But in general, the EMG is zero. And also sleepwalking does usually not happen during REM sleep, but during non-REM sleep, deep sleep predominantly. And in REM sleep, you also have these periodic eye movements that give REM sleep, rapid eye movement sleep, its name. So when you look at textbooks, medical textbooks, and read about sleep, you usually read about these ultradian rhythms of 90-minute period that are comprised of light sleep, deep sleep, and REM. So here have an example here. On the left-hand side, on the y-axis, you have the sleep stages, REM sleep, light sleep, and deep sleep, and you go to bed at 11 p.m., and then you go into light sleep, and later into deep sleep, and you turn into to REM sleep, and then you repeat the cycle again all over for four to five to six times. And this is the common knowledge in what medical doctors usually learn in their courses. But when you look at and interesting is also that you see that the duration of deep sleep decreases over the night, and the duration of REM sleep increases over the night. So these are all findings that are known for several decades already. But if you look more closely into what you record in the lab, you get something quite different. It is not this clear pattern of deep sleep, light sleep, and REM sleep all over, repeating all over again. But you have many of these little short brief arousals. You see here an arousal and here all these peaks. These are short arousals that either change the sleep stage in which you are, or you straight go back to the sleep stage. So here, for example, awakening, and then you go back to light sleep. The question is, do these arousals contain any useful information, so to say? When you ask a sleep researcher, they say, oh, these are just random perturbations and doesn't change nothing on the homeostatic characteristics of sleep. So you have an arousal and then which is in perturbation, and then you go back into sleep. But as a statistical physicist, you want to look into this more carefully, and the first thing you would do is to make a statistics of the durations of these vague states. And this was what Plamen, I don't know, with student Chang Lo did quite some a while ago. They plotted a CDF of the durations of vague durations and the CDF of the durations of these sleep durations. And what you find there is here the open symbols are the vague durations and the filled circles are sleep durations. And what you find there is that on a double logarithmic plot, you get a straight line for the durations of short awakenings. And this is up to 10 minutes, because after 10 minutes, you cannot talk anymore about a brief awakening. So this is a pretty good power law fit with an exponent of 1.3. However, the sleep durations, they follow an exponential behavior. This is a log-ln plot, and it's a straight line on a log-ln plot. So whereas in wake, we do not have a characteristic scale, we cannot say something about a typical duration of a wake epoch during the night. We can say so about sleep durations. We can say that typically we are 22 minutes asleep before it is interrupted by a short awakening. So this is a difference that is quite interesting, this coexistence of a power law and an exponential distribution. And you may ask now, how would this look like when I go into sleep disorders? Is this something that is stable across sleep disorders, or only found in healthy subjects? And how about I consider different sleep stages? I distinguish REM, deep sleep, and light sleep. And if you do the statistics there, here again, we see the CDF. Actually, this is a survival plot, so 1 minus the CDF. And we see here, again, the result from before, for healthy subjects, but for sleep apnea, now this exponent changes. They still have a power law distribution, but the exponent changes significantly from 1.3 to 1.5. So the open symbols here are now sleep apnea subjects, whereas the filled circles are healthy subjects. And when we go to distinguish between the different sleep stages, we see, first of all, no difference between healthy and sleep apnea. So they follow all an exponential distribution. However, the time constant changes from 10 minutes to 12 minutes. So we have longer deep sleep epochs than we typically have REM sleep epochs. So it looks like we found a physiological finding that is so stable that even sleep disorders may not change it. By changing, I mean that the power law would be would be kind of destroyed. The power law would not be conserved when I go to to sleep apnea patients, for example. So other studies ask the question, yeah, is this something that is universal across, for example, mammalian species, or something that is really inherently true only for humans? And here a follow-up study, again by Chang Lo and Plum and Ivanov, taking a cat sleep data, or data from rat and from mice. And again, you see this many brief awakenings throughout the sleep period, or for a rat, it's throughout, yeah, it's actually throughout the day, because they have very short sleep epochs and many awakenings. And when you do the statistics, you show here is now the probability density, so it's not the CDF, so we have to add plus one, right? We had before an exponent of 1.3, now it's 2.3. So when we look at the distribution of wake durations, we again find a power law. So for humans, we saw this before, but also for cats, for rats, and for mice, we get this power law behavior, which is quite stable across these different mammalian species. However, the exponential distribution of sleep durations, they look different now. They, we have here the sleep durations for humans, followed by cats with 11 minutes, tau of 11 minutes. Then we have rats and we have mice. So here the exponent dramatically changes, and it was shown that this is related to metabolic rate. No? The mice and rats, they have much higher metabolic rate than humans. Could also be related to brain size, but the important thing is that it's still exponential distribution and the time constant changes. So we have here coexistence of both a scale invariant power law and an exponential process, exponential process with characteristic time scale, as output of a single sleep regulatory mechanism. And this is stable across various mammalian species and has not been observed in any other integrated physiological systems, and also has relevance to a physiological process that is called maturation. So here you see a figure from the paper of Mark Bloomberg that shows that for rats, for baby rats, this power law develops over time only. So you have here two days old rats that show an exponential distribution for the wake durations, and the power law only develops over time. So only with about 3 weeks, they come close to a power law. Whereas for sleep durations, you have the exponential decay, and just tau increases over time, but the exponential decay stays the same. So when we talk about this coexistence of scale invariant power law process and an exponential process, then this is something that reminds us on a physics phenomenon that is known as self-organized criticality. And so it was suggested by Per Bach and Tang and Wiesenfeld about 30 years ago. And this metaphor is always described as you're going to the beach and you're putting sand on top of each other, and you have a flat surface, and then you let sand tickle on the surface, and then you build up a little pile. And from time to time, when you cross a critical angle, you trigger an avalanche, of sand. And then again, you put more sand and you build up again the pile. And then again, it collapses with an avalanche. And so this is a slowly driven process. Obviously, it's a non-equilibrium. You can trigger avalanches of any size. And when you do a statistics, you get a power law for the avalanche sizes. And the waiting times between the avalanches are exponentially distributed. So this is called self-organized criticality by Per Bach, because this sand pile is behaving completely different to typical physical systems that we know from thermodynamics. When you think about a phase transition, then between, for example, water and ice, it is quite difficult to keep the system at the critical point. And the system is very unstable close to the critical point and wants to run away from the critical point, so to say. But here, the sand pile is all the time driving itself into criticality. So it's like a kind of a masochistic system that all the time wants to be in the critical range in order to be able to collapse. So then, so Per Bach, basically he saw now self-organized criticality almost everywhere, and people started to check experimentally what if really self-organized criticality explains nature, as he claimed in his book, How Nature Works. And one experiment I want to mention is by Jens Feder, that tried all kinds of grains and actually found that a sand pile, or when you do this experiment with real sand, then it doesn't show a clear power law. It's more like a stretched exponential, and you have to use a rice, and in particular basmati rice, in order to get really this power law behavior. And Stefano explained me 2 weeks ago why it has to be basmati rice. It has to have this elongated shape in order that an avalanche actually can stop. So we have here this parallel now between arousals in the brain. These are active states. And something that we can say is like an avalanche, perhaps in the brain, it shows a power law behavior. And sleep are these inactive states. So we can say, okay, this is like these are like waiting times between the avalanches, and they are exponentially distributed. So all this kind of gives an indication that this paradigm of sleep as a homeostatic process is not quite true, at least not on short scales. So on short scales, sleep is perhaps a state of non-equilibrium. And these arousals that we see are not simply random perturbations, but perhaps necessary elements of sleep regulation. Because if we won't have these arousals, then sleep would be perhaps more similar to coma. And given these arousals, we kind of assure a reversibility of sleep. But these are hypotheses that need to be tested. And I want to talk now more about another work we did. And we ask ourselves the question, how can we model this occurrence of arousals? How can we come up with a simple model, including a network of sleep and wake-promoting neurons, to reproduce this observed behavior of arousal and sleep dynamics? There's some previous work by Chang Lo and Plum and Ivanov, but here we tried a a different approach and considered first the wake and sleep promoting centers in the brain. So if you take a brain, a human brain, then you have many centers that are wake promoting, that contain wake promoting neurons that either use monoaminergic neurons or cholinergic neurons. You have here locus ceruleus, you have the RAFE, the basal forebrain. So all of them have a particular function in keeping us awake and alert. And all of them together, they are considered the ascending arousal pathway, and they project ultimately to the cortex and keep us awake and alert. Now in sleep, we have here a center that is called a neuronal center that's called ventrolateral preoptic area that sits basically on the junction where all the input from these wake promoting neurons kind of converge. And during sleep, it is excreting GABA, which is an inhibiting neurotransmitter. And the GABA inhibits all these neuronal centers and won't let them fire and be active so that we can sleep, basically. And when we want to understand what's happening during sleep with these brief arousals, we just need to look at this pathway of the VLPO and the suppression of wake-promoting neurons. So let's have a look more closely. And actually what happens is that the neurons here, they are suppressed. They don't fire as they would do during wake. However, they have something that is called an intrinsic noise or neuronal noise. So they still have some kind of activity. And if you look at this more carefully, this neuronal noise is actually what is known in neuroscience, I think, called subthreshold voltage fluctuations. And they are mainly from two sources. One is stochastic openings and closing of these membrane channels, voltage-gated membrane channels. And the second is that there are just random background synaptic activity. But now the interesting thing about this subthreshold voltage fluctuations is that it increases with lower temperature. So this we were quite surprised of. So here you see on the x-axis the temperature, and here the noise level. So this is just the standard deviation of the noise, sigma. And for different types of neurons, this is a Hodgkin-Huxley neuron, and this is some cortical neuron. So they increase in activity, the neuronal noise increases in activity with lower temperatures. So this is quite interesting and would help in our model, as I will tell you in a minute. So first, what we did is we made a network of these wake promoting neurons. So these are the silenced neurons during sleep, but you can couple them. And you assume that they still have this neuronal noise. So they're all coupled and they have this neuronal noise. They are wobbling, right? And the point is now that from time to time, when you look at their integrated behavior, they can reach to a voltage that is above the acceptability threshold, and then they fire sporadically and they fire to the cortex and trigger their short arousal. But at the same time, we want to be asleep, so the VLPO through GABA inhibits this activity, and we go back into sleep. So we have here this sleep inertia. In the model, this is as a coefficient of B, and you have an inhibition, and then you continue with this wobbling. From time to time, you get an it's like you can think about it like a volcano, right? When I discussed this with Plamen, he said this is like a volcano. It's wobbling, and from time to time you have an eruption. Yes. So now this neuronal noise, or when you look at this integrated noise from all this network of wake-promoting neurons over time, then it is performing something like a random walk, right? You can say, okay, I have a random walk, and if I cross the threshold of zero here, then I'm awake, and I have a sleep-restoring, the sleep inertia, sleep-restoring current that pushes me back into sleep. And when I'm in sleep, I perform just a free random walk, and just under the condition that I cannot go deeper than deep sleep, right? So I have here some border, and when I reach this border, then I have a probability of going up, and when I go up, I can cross here, and I'm pushed back again into sleep. This sleep inertia is has a logarithmic potential, so it means the farther you are away, the more likely is that you stay awake. Also, this is also what we know from when we ourselves, we get up in the middle of the night, and we start to check emails, or we do some more complex tasks. So it's much more difficult for us to go back to sleep after this. The longer we are awake, then if we stay in bed and we try to fall asleep again after a short period of time. So so this is the dynamics, basically a Wiener process during sleep. And we have this logarithmic potential when we are awake. And now we learned that this the neuronal noise is temperature dependent. So one could now hypothesize that when I have a low temperature, I have a higher neuronal noise. So this should lead to more arousals. And when I have a high temperature, I have a lower noise level, and this should lead to less arousal. So the model would basically predict more arousals during when the temperature is low, and higher number of arousals when we are at higher temperature. And then we thought about, okay, we have this model, but how would we test it? And it was very practical that just opposite the building next door, they have a laboratory and grow zebrafish. They're also doing sleep analysis of zebrafish. Zebrafish has similar sleep cycles than humans, and you can genetically manipulate them and study also some sleep disorders on them. And we just ask Leo Applebaum to perform an experiment, just change the temperature of the water. This means this translates directly to the temperature of the fish, and look what is their arousal and sleep statistics. And it was quite surprising to us that here is the blue is the prediction of the model, and the experiment with the fish, this is about averaged about 90 of these fish. And it follows pretty well the prediction of the model, more arousals in lower water temperatures. Of course, you cannot go above 34 degrees because they are going to just die. And lower temperatures, they also do not tolerate very well. And you have also these problems of condensation on the lenses when the water gets too cold, because this tracking of the fish is done automatically by optical instruments. So you can do you can also look at, so this was the number of arousals. You can look at the percentage of sleep. You can look at the mean sleep bout durations and mean wake bout durations, and model and experiments, they pretty well coincide. And also when you check the exponential distributions for sleep durations and the power law distribution for wake durations, you get a pretty good agreement between experiments and model. And and so if I would summarize these findings, then I would say that brief arousals are an integral part of healthy sleep regulation and are found in mammalian and non-mammalian species. So we saw here a zebrafish, but there, I don't know about other, actually about other findings, but zebrafish and mammalian species, there's also some work on sheep done, and they all show this behavior. Arousal durations are power law distributed, so it's scale invariant, and sleep stage durations are exponential distributed, so have a specific time scale. We showed here in preliminary results that perhaps this accumulated neuronal subthreshold voltage fluctuations in the wake-promoting neurons can be the origin of this spontaneous brief arousals during sleep. And interestingly, the arousal statistics changes with temperature. We have more arousals at lower temperature, at least for ectothermic animals. For if you take mammals, the experiments that have to be done, but it's not quite as simple to change the temperature, the ambient temperature. This doesn't necessarily translate directly into body temperature of the animal, as we know. So this is an experiment that needs to be done also for mammalian species, but it's not quite as simple. So the question is now, okay, good, but is there anything that is, I mean, why do we care? Is we have these arousals, and perhaps we can find some better parameters to characterize sleep, but is there anything more into it? And we found a relationship between this arousability and something that is called sudden infant death syndrome. So sudden infant death syndrome is a devastating thing that happens to little babies in the beginning of their life. So you have here, so they suddenly die in their sleep, okay? Very traumatic for everyone involved. And here you see a distribution of 2 years from 1992 to 2001, but it doesn't change very much over time. So you have here the age of the infant and the percent or the occurrence of this sudden infant death syndrome. And you see there's a peak about 2 months of age. You're pretty safe after 6 months of age. And the recommendations that you get when you become a parent, when you are in the clinics and you do these courses on how to take care of the baby, they also talk about SIDS, and the recommendations they give you is always temperature related. So they tell you, do not put the baby in too many blankets, keep the room temperature at a low level, and put the baby on the back and not on the stomach. And when you ask them, why is it like this? They tell you this is these are empirical results. They cannot tell you why it is. And what we think is perhaps this peak, when you look at this peak in occurrence of SIDS, this very much corresponds to this lag in temperature regulation of the baby. So what you see here is, again, the age in month, and here you have some surrogate for temperature regulation. It is lowest about the age of 2 months of the baby. And because they have to change when the baby is born, it is more like a fish, basically. It has ectothermic traits. It first has to develop over a period of half a year its own temperature regulation. So they are very sensitive to ambient temperature. So when the temperature of the room is too high, they get overheated. When it's too low, they get very fast cooled down. So thermoregulation in very young infants is not fully developed. They show ectothermic traits similar to fish, more susceptible to higher ambient temperature and higher risk for SIDS. So how does this now go together with arousals? One could think the following. If we have a normal baby, okay, and low ambient temperature means we have a higher neuronal noise. So higher neuronal noise means higher arousability of the baby, not good for the parents because it would wake up easier and cry more during the night. But if their head gets stuck in some blanket or on the mattress, then it would wake up and cry, and the parents would help it to get released out of this condition. However, when we have a high ambient temperature, then we have a lower level of neuronal noise. The baby may sleep better, but it could also sleep too well and not wake up and fall into this hypoxic coma when their mouth or nose gets stuck in some blanket. So, of course, this only happens for susceptible children. So if you have a healthy infant, then this is the level of arousability. And in the night, when you have a lower temperature, it is higher, but towards the early morning hours, when also most of the SIDS are happening, you have this circadian shift. So lower neuronal noise levels, less arousability. But if you have a vulnerable infant that starts out with a lower neuronal noise level, then this could be quite critical. So you see here that when now the circadian shift is lowering the degree of arousability, they can get into this dangerous zone where a sudden infant death syndrome could happen. So higher temperature, lower neuronal noise, lower arousability could increase SIDS. Of course, this is only a hypothesis, and I'm not an expert on SIDS, but I think it's worth thinking about it. So with this, I would like to thank you very much, and I'm happy to answer questions.
Thanks a lot, Ronnie. So I open the talk to discussion. So if there are questions, please.
Hi, I have a question. Or maybe
Francesco, you wanted to ask?
Thanks a lot for very nice talks. I'm sorry, I probably missed because I got interrupted at some point. But so what you call wake is, so you put together micro arousals to like longer periods of wake, right?
Yes. So you take for what I showed you here, you take what a sleep technician in the lab scores as wake. Okay, but you can repeat this analysis and you can say, okay, I do not rely on the sleep technician, because a sleep technician also just takes everything in the window of 30 seconds. So the shortest wake epoch would be 30 seconds. But you can also just look at EEG activity, and you would see that very often throughout the night we have a low frequency EEG, but sometimes these low frequencies are intercepted by high frequency oscillations, and this is an indication for an arousal. Then you can look: is this accompanied by some body movement? Very often, you see also an increase in EMG or EOG, but sometimes also not. So, if it's an intrinsic arousal, you would only see it in the EEG. It looks very similar than Beck.
And those shorter arousals stay on the same power flow.
They stay on the same power flow. Yes.
And for sleep, so you look at all of sleep, and so if you look at like let's say stage 2 versus stage 3, stage 4, you get similar exponential distributions.
Yes. The exponential distributions are for the sleep durations. They are somewhat different in their characteristic time. So the deep sleep durations are typically longer than the REM sleep durations, and light sleep is somewhere in between, but we are talking here about 2-3 minutes. That's not very big difference.
Thanks. Thank you
Francesco.
Marco, you had a question?
Yes. So thank you very much for the presentation. And I cannot figure out why the neuronal noise depends upon temperature.
Maybe
your perspective about why.
Yes, so that's a very good question. It comes out from the Hodgkin-Huxley model when you put temperature as a parameter, and also when you do experiments. But these are very old experiments. So, physiologically, I do not have a good answer to this, why ion channel activity should increase for lower temperature. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I ask certain physiologists. They also, what they told me, also didn't convince me very much. So this is something I think should be there should be some focus on in research to better understand it. Or maybe there is some thing already done, and I'm just not aware of this. So if someone in this audience knows about it, then I would be very happy to learn about it. But I don't have a good explanation.
Okay, thank you.
So related to your model, no? Because you have a model that reproduces quite well, no? What you see in experiments, or at least yes. The distribution. So, and you mentioned that relations with self-organized criticality, sand piles, and so on. So I couldn't really get the relationship from the model. So do you understand a little better where are the avalanches? So what causes the avalanches in the model? So normally when you have avalanche activity, it means that something triggers something else. So what is triggered? Because it looked like more like fluctuations and a cutoff Yes. Like, do you have some cascade events? And how maybe I just didn't understand. So I just, that's why.
Yeah, so this triggering here integrated behavior of the wake promoting neurons, this integrated current, so to say, is of different size, right? So because you can have a few neurons only participating in this eruption, so to say, or you can have many neurons. Then you have a much larger integrated current. So it's just depending on how many neurons would at the same time have an indifference problem. So if many neurons at the same time are in their noise going at the same direction, then the response would be much higher than if they would counteract each other.
Okay, but is there an effect of the coupling between the neurons? So like one neuron fires and drags together some others. So this is what I would understand as an avalanche in this organized criticality context.
You hit exactly on the painful place. So we haven't studied this. This is what we have done afterwards is just to look at it coarse grain, so to say, just at the integrated behavior. But one needs to look really if in this network avalanches are happening. I mean, we know from cultures of neurons that these avalanches are happening. There are this famous paper of Becks and Plants that shows this experimentally, this avalanche in neuronal cultures. But we haven't found a good way to show this in the model. I mean, we are struggling a little bit with the analysis of the individual neurons, you know. So yeah, and so, I'm looking for somebody who helps me with this because the postdoc who did this work, she went on to do something else, and I'm basically looking for someone that helps me to better understand this network of wake promoting neurons. So if you know someone, I'm happy to, or someone of you would like to work on this, I would be thrilled, you know, would be very happy.
Maybe.
Francesco.
So in your model, is the noise difference in the sleep and in the wake stage, or do you have the same noise levels?
No, we do not look at the wake stage, because in wake it's completely different. In wake, the neurons are active, they are firing constantly. So we do not deal with.
But that's wake. Where you get okay. So the part that produces the avalanche doesn't have the noise.
No. So this is just during sleep. Everything is more or less quiet. You have a little bit of wobbling because of the neuronal noise, and you have the interactions between these neuronal clusters, and from time to time you have these eruptions. But how they are exactly triggered and trigger surrounding neurons also to fire, I do not know at this point.
Perhaps related to that, so we have data where we show that cortical activations during sleep, so what you would call up states, follow power law statistics during sleep. So this was published a few months ago. PNAS.
Oh, could you?
The paper by,
could you send me this, please? This paper. This I'm not aware of it. This.
I can put the reference on the Zoom chat.
Yes.
This is from cortical recordings with voltage imaging.
Very nice. Yeah. Like to learn about it.
I'm glad to hear that avalanches indeed exist, even in the brain.
Many people got very skeptical on Per Buck's predictions, and I'm always surprised. He wrote only one page in his book, How Nature Works, on criticality in the brain, and it doesn't have much of a substance, to my opinion, but everybody is citing it, and everybody says, oh, Per Buck said there's self-organized criticality in the brain, but there's no proof, actually. You know, it's just a story.
Yeah, well, that's the point. He was saying that self-organized AI here, there, and there, and then, okay, covering the territory, you know.
Yes. Actually, one can take his book and go from page to page and tries to disprove him, you know. This would be a nice series of papers.
Yeah, so maybe Yeah, so I put up the reference on the chat. I mean, on the criticality and the maybe I think the interesting, maybe the most interesting work is from maybe you know the Viola Priesemann work,
where with Geisel, with Theo Geisel. Yeah, I know this.
Yeah,
work.
Yeah, but then she also more recently had this nice. Estimators where she shows that essentially the brain is at most of the time at a near critical regime, not exactly at critical.
The funny story about that paper, that's the only paper on almost the only paper on brain criticality that I cite in my book in the conclusions. And the reason is that she uses a method to explain, I mean, a model to explain, I don't know if it's exactly that paper, but to explain why the brain is operating close to the critical point, which is exactly the method that we introduced 20 years ago. I mean, the mechanism that we discussed 20 years ago for sand piles and then for the Barkhausen noise and then for avalanche plasticity is exactly the same equation. So I was very, of course, she doesn't know, she reinvented it, but that's very funny, you know?
Yeah.
So she calls it, I think, something like synaptic. I don't remember anymore. Plasticity or something like that.
Yes. Yeah. I have read this paper. It's a PRL, right? It's already 10 years old or something. Yeah, in 2013 or 12.
So are there any data with direct recordings from the VLPO?
No, I mean, there are not, I mean, direct recordings from the VLPO. There are these records, I think, in Harvard Medical School, they, in the lab of Cliff Saber, they do experiments where they selectively kill these neuronal centers, right? They kill VLPO or the LC, and they look how this affects sleep. But I'm not sure that they measure the neuronal activity of a particular cluster. They just look at the integrated behavior because I don't know if how much you would affect the sleep of the animal if you measure also directly inside the neuronal cluster. I don't know experimentally if this would be possible. You can tell me. You're an experimentalist.
I mean, the challenge is to do it for a longer time so that...
Yes. So they do it typically over a period of 50 days because it takes time to develop. The animal needs to get used to having less neuronal sensors in the brain, you know, and still tries to sleep. And I'm not aware of any direct recordings, so to say. Yeah.
So I don't know if there are other questions in the audience. Otherwise, I really thank everybody, Ronnie for sure, for giving us this very thought-provoking talk, and everybody for participating in the discussion. And thank you very much. And so the next seminar, I think, is not scheduled yet.
Marco, there is the seminar of Stevens. Or the 15th of February.
Okay, it is scheduled. So 15th of February, we'll have a seminar on, obesity.
Conductum.
So how about human behavior and how it leads to obesity. And so it's a mixture of sociology and physics and statistics by Christoph Stevens, University of Mexico, Mexico City. And so I welcome you to have a look at the webpage and then maybe check out the program. Okay, with
it's
this
in February. It's in February, right?
In February. So let me turn off the YouTube so that.